Good morning.
Good morning.
Boy, in the crazy world in which we live, it's nice to see that some old habits die hard. We still have folks loitering out in the dark, that's a good sign of our community. By way of announcements, I have some good news, and then I have some very good news. Good news, we do have our church cabinet meeting. That's at noon today, after you all get a chance to get home and maybe get at least make a sandwich. And you can zoom in to our discussions from our various ministry teams. And the better news than that is that Ashley Gillette and her husband, Margaret Plank's granddaughter, and her husband, Nick, are able to celebrate the birth of their first daughter. Whose name is Ophelia Ray, and she was born on Thursday. About 1 pound, 10 ounces, is that right? About 13 inches long, breathing on her own, doing okay. So we certainly want to celebrate, and we certainly want to congratulate Margaret on his grandchild. Do we have any other announcements this morning? Did you say 1 pound? I did. 1 pound, 10 ounces, that's right. Tiny baby, but doing okay. All right. We'll begin.
When people tear apart all you have made, you come to us time and again. You walk the streets as one of us, wearing a mask perhaps, yearning to know and to be known, listen and to teach. Spirit, you blow through broken lives, renewing all that has withered and died. You come to each of us, challenging prejudices and fears. May we be open to your Holy Spirit. May we be generous with what we have, creating, saving, enlivening God. Make us more eager to welcome with love all who are yours. Amen. And now the prayer of confession. Holy One, we are fortunate. world has ever seen. How is it possible some children are thrown away? We live in the best defended country, by far the most powerful, the most secure, yet there are thousands crying to you today from shelters and prison camps, crying they only want to go home. Dearest one, this is not the kingdom we wanted. We are ashamed. Once upon a time, Christ stood up to the powers that be and transformed small, insignificant people into disciples, healers, and peacemakers. That is what we hope to be in this community. Act through us, use us, we pray, as agents of your grace. And lastly, the words of assurance. Christ came into the world to save sinners, accepts you as you are, forgives your failures, frees you from the power of death, because you are beloved and you were meant to be.
Friends, let us share a few moments in stillness, reflecting on all that has been and all that we look ahead to, sometimes with hope, sometimes with some trepidation as well. This week, let us especially pray for Lisa Gorschel's family. Her sister passed away suddenly after surviving cancer. That's an awful blow. Let us celebrate with Ashley and with Nick. Let's feel the worries about paying bills, about how to get by, of our neighbors, and of people all around this community and all around this world, as we open our hearts and minds to God's presence within and among us. Let us pray. this autumn day for grain to be harvested for a late afternoon soft amber light. Thank you for this chance to focus again on what is blessed and beautiful and bountiful. Free us from the resentment and worries and burdens of times gone by. Help us see, perceive your light within ourselves and in those we hold dear, and in people we barely noticed until now. We ask that you purify us, please. Cast out of us all that is deceitful, anxious, and cruel. May your love and energy find a good place to dwell in us and within our community. Show us what you would have us do to make this world a safer, kinder, more beautiful place. Dear God, we ask you to comfort our friends, neighbors, and loved ones struggling with sickness, grief, hardship, looking for work. We ask that you bring your holy love to the people of our small town, but also to wherever the homeless and the hungry must sleep. We pray for peace, prosperity, but not without justice for the oppressed, and not without dignity for those in need. All this we pray in the name of your child who long ago taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Once again, good morning. Well, friends, today's text about water, cool water pouring out of a rock, is part of a series that shows us how people who've been enslaved for generations learn how to trust this mysterious God, this force that claims he's bringing them to a new home. And this isn't the first time they've questioned a voice out of the sky. Soon after they set out, they rested a place where the water is too bitter to drink, and they complain until Moses changes its taste. God has Moses toss some special wood into the pool. And last week we heard or sunrise. And now they have reason to worry again. They camp at Rephidim, but there's no water source nearby. And thirst makes the crowd grow surly. Moses is caught between an anxious mob and a God who's in no great hurry to help. We're at Massa and Meribah. Massa means testing. Testing, not as in special test, but testing as in, darling, settle down. You're testing my patience. That kind of testing. Meribah means bickering, which is what happens when patience has just about worn out. The Lord be with you. A reading from the book of Exodus. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water. Children and livestock with thirst. So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock at Horeb. Smite the rock, and water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massa and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" Well, let us pray. In my mouth, and the meditations of all of our hearts and minds be truly acceptable in your sight, dear God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. What we have here, to steal a line from Cool Hand Luke, and no, I won't fake the accent, is failure to communicate. The Jews who fled Egypt don't really know this formless God whom Moses talks to now and then. Now, way back when people did. Adam and Eve, Noah, and then Abraham, and Sarah, and Jacob, Enoch, perhaps. Let's compare the book of Genesis. Well, there's maybe a couple, three. But not a whole loose confederation of tribes. So if you were to ask the average person on this trek, who's leading you? He probably pointed Moses up And when they're uneasy and thirsty, they demand that he fix things. They're convinced he's the one in charge. But then Moses objects, I'm not the manager. And then he goes off by himself to get help from a pillar of fire. Here. God's chosen people, yes, but don't you think they're testing this unknown God as well? Right now, they're very close to thinking that this strange old man is their new Pharaoh. Can he be trusted? What does he want? And so Moses cries out to God, "What shall I do with them?" When people press in, he argues they're really questioning God. They're in a crisis. Moses wants to quit. Meanwhile, the only one who can save them just sort of watches from on high. Can people learn to believe in a God who discourages hoarding? Don't take too much. Just what you need each day. A little extra. So you don't have to collect on the Sabbath. A little extra that day, but a God who discourages hoarding but is responsive to genuine need. And looking at this cloud, this voice, this whatever it is, people wonder, are you a God like Pharaoh? Meaning in part, will you come down on us when you get frustrated and petulant and bored? Now, it's been ages and ages since the Hebrews actually questioned authority. And now that they can, they're beginning to realize that they have a voice. And social scientists argue that some of this grumbling is one of the phases that communities in flux have to go through. When we cross a frontier, try to adjust to significant changes, we leave some part of ourselves behind. Years ago, Bruce Tuckman, who used to teach at Ohio State, I apologize to the Jennings, the Ohio State, came up with four stages, he said, were necessary and inevitable for a team to grow, face up to challenges, tackle problems, and deliver results. And he labeled those stages forming, storming, norming, and performing. Now, from the time Moses gathered his people together until he led them across the sea, Tuckman would say this was the first phase of forming. People find out things about one another. They learn what they have in common, what sorts of skills they possess, and what hopes they share. And for a lot of you, this would have taken up maybe the first couple of weeks in your college dorm. Who's that across the hall? Who's that down there? Oh, this bug guy plays the cover. Oh, well, she does. However you have found out about one another. For a lot of you that have lived in this community for a long time, you know when they first built Tilton Park 60 more years ago and more, and they're all new houses. So forth, or in the Knolls, or along Pond Street, out there, that's mysteriously past Portland, but still has a DeKalb mailbox. These neighborhoods we move into, lots of times we're in a position where we're in a stage of forming some sort of bond. Who are we? How do we do? Are we going to do trick or treating? When? What houses are okay to go to? Well, then comes the storming stage when things are liable to get a bit tense. We disagree and we start to criticize how things are going. This isn't how we used to, or now this feels wrong. This feels wrong. As things get harder. Some feel upset. For there's bound to be some conflict and some degree of stress, unless, of course, people really just don't care. And then comes a time for norming, talking in planes. This is how we manage things now. These are our policies, formal or informal. So, okay, it's Palm Sunday's coming up. That's just when we go down to the basement and find that paper mache donkey again and dust it off and bring it out of the dark. This is what we do. Now, this era of norming, the sense. So how do we operate? Who are we? And what rules, formal, informal, do we have? In Scripture, this begins next week, rather dramatically. Moses comes down from the mountain, toting the Ten Commandments, and much more than that. The scribes infer that he also brings back the written and the unwritten law, which is to say the customs, the rites, and the rules that are found in Leviticus and Deuteronomy. All the stuff you don't want to read. Right? They were supposed to unite this community. And we may contest a great number of them. Paul says, ignore those that oppress you, follow Jesus Christ. Centuries, though, before Jesus was born, there was the Torah. And observant Jews have performed it. Try to ever since. Exodus shows us how troubled people work out their relationship with each other, with a new leader, and with God as well. Complaining, quarreling, worrying. We're about 6 weeks away from elections, and we all know it's bound to get uglier and more divisive in our workplaces, maybe in our families. And so the rumbling out there in the wilderness once a long time ago, we feel that tension too. And as you watch the news and as you read the paper and so forth, you may dare to ask yourself, is the Lord among us or not? As you decide what this church ought to become. I'm not Moses believing I know that, but nor are you grumbling, and I'm grateful for that. But I'm going to retire next month after a long run, and I'm proud to say that I've served here as pastor longer than anybody before. That's hard for me to believe. And these stages I've mentioned of forming, storming and norming and performing. Yes, search committees and congregations pass through them as well. And as you take your time, you may achieve a greater intimacy with one another as you explore what to change and what to keep.
And that's really my great hope.
The other day I was looking at something by I'll never say his name, but William Langewisch. I know the name in print, I can't say it aloud. He was a journalist and an airplane pilot besides. And he cautions that you should not see the desert simply as some faraway place of little rain. Because you see, there are many forms of thirst. We all thirst. For companionship, for a sense of belonging. And often too, we thirst for something we can't even actually name. Walter Brueggemann, who's our top UCC Old Testament scholar, 87, contrasts how people once try to satisfy such a great thirst in the Bible with how we're trained to seek relief today. In the pages of Exodus, Brueggemann writes, there's a clear path. somebody names it and brings it to God. And then God intercedes directly, or else sends a message. You ought to do this.
Bang that rock with your staff.
This is how the Jews cope with conditions in the wilderness. Now, in the world of television today, we don't seek help from God. We're urged to trust some product we can buy. Brueggemann chides the problem may be loneliness, or stress, or bad odor. When the product is used, life is powerfully transformed from a companionship, calmness, popularity, peace, joy, and well-being. Trouble is, Brueggemann says, it's not so. Whatever magical products provide, they can't deliver us as God does, from hunger to fullness, from thirst to water, blindness to sight, from poverty to well-being, and in the end, from death to life. Only God can do that, Brueggemann says, since there are no other miracle workers. Never have been. To their credit, these wanderers, long before us, didn't try to cover up that they doubted, they panicked, they quarreled along the way. In fact, they did the opposite. They turned their trials into place names, which was the best way to make sure that these stories would be retold. Where are we, Mom? We're in squabbling. Why do we call it squabbling? One lesson of Exodus is that unqualified and unprepared people really can adjust and grow as they find ways to trust each other and the God who's drawing them onward. Perhaps when we're young, we think those older than us have discovered the secrets of life or have some sort of insider knowledge, but then we grow up and realize that part of becoming an adult is figuring it out as you go along, without secret knowledge, sometimes without knowing where your next step will take you. And Anne Lamott may have been thinking of scripture, she really wasn't, but she could have been. It's funny. I always imagined when I was a kid that adults have some kind of inner toolbox full of shiny tools. The saw of discernment, the hammer of wisdom, the sandpaper of patience. But when I grew up, I found that life handed you these rusty, bent, old tools. Friendship, prayer, conscience, honesty, and said, do the best you can with these. They will have to do. And mostly, against all odds, they do.
May that ever be so.
And of course, always. God bless you all.
Thank you.
Let's stay outside as long as we can, huh? Before we have to sequester ourselves away. Let's take a little extra time maybe to see the leaves turn, to feel the breeze change, to appreciate this, well, this adjustment that we go through the seasons. And there's a lot of need, and there's a lot of hurt, and there's a lot of worry out there. And in as much as we're all affected by that, each of us here, in a very real way, are a part of the solution, are a part of the balm, the healing, the help we can give to one another. And so I'll say again that Christ has no body now but yours, no arms but yours, no legs but yours. Well, and the person next to you, and the person that way, and the people you care about. But yours are the feet with which Christ is to go about this world doing good. And yours are the words with which he will bless us now. So let's do our very best to bless one another.